going. All right. I got the thumbs up. That means we are live on Facebook. So we're so thankful to those of you who are joining us from your couch, your living room, your family's house, wherever you happen to be this morning. Very thankful that that media is available for us and for you to join us, whether that means you're traveling and you can be with your home church, whether it means you're home because of COVID and you can be with your home church. We're so thankful that you've joined us this morning. Also thankful to all of you who, despite a Thanksgiving holiday and a football game that may or may not have gone your way yesterday, are here this morning. And so we're thankful to all of you for being here. We say a lot at Hunter Hills, we are just a group of regular folks, right? We're a group of broken people trying to learn to live, love, and connect like we see Jesus did in the New Testament. So we're going to get started this morning with a song. Yes? Okay, whew. It's family worship, and Jordan knows I have a tendency to mess these things up, so I got the nod. So we're going to stand up, and we're going to start with a song. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, the weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy day, Christ
Good morning and welcome to Hunter Hills. I'm so glad to see all of you in this post-Thanksgiving Sunday. I know it's hard to find your way back, but I'm so glad you're here. And to those watching online, we're so glad and grateful that you are joining us today. Today's a special Sunday for two different reasons. The first is that today is the very first Sunday of Advent, and we are joining Christians, past, present, and future, in the celebration and participation of this season. Advent has been practiced as early as the 4th century. So we're joining churches today of all denominations all over the world, churches high and low and everybody in between, in the practice of Advent. We're all today lighting the candle of hope together, and we'll continue to practice that all 4 Sundays leading up to Christmas. And we invite you to do this in your own personal lives as well. The kids and their families are doing Advent at home, which, moms and dads, that starts today. You can find the information on our Facebook page. But we invite you to do it at home as well. You can find devotionals, there are books, there are blogs, you can get a daily email, whatever it is. I think this season is more fitting than ever before to examine where we are putting our hope this year, or where we're finding our peace or our joy in these difficult times, or what we love and where we are expecting to receive love from. It is quite fitting that we go through this season together this year. So we invite you to participate with us as we participate together on Sundays. The second reason today is special is because today is family worship. For those of you doing the math, it's been a whole year since our last family worship. We did it, the last one we did was the first Sunday of Advent last year, which is so hard for me to believe. And for those of you who haven't been able to join us for family worship before, these are special Sundays in the lives of our church family for several reasons. One is that the whole church family is in here with the exception of babies and toddlers and the people that are caring for them, and they're in here for the whole time. So I know we've been doing that for about the past 6 months now. Because of the pandemic, we haven't had children's worship, but today we're doing it with a little bit more intentionality. Today we're being led in worship by children and their families and teens, children and their families. So typically we invite families of all kinds, but today it is just biological families. But we are a family of faith here at Hunter Hills, and today we celebrate that. Today we get a fuller picture of the kingdom of God, and that we'll be led by people of all ages from the front, from up here. So just as you invited children to share around your Thanksgiving table what they are thankful for this year, or just as you invited them to pray or tell a joke or whatever it is, it's important for you to hear from them, and it's important for us today gathered around God's table that we hear from those children. And I've said it before, and surely it's stuck, but if it hasn't, moms and dads, take a deep breath. Children are welcome into this church service each and every Sunday at Hunter Hills. We welcome children fully and completely, the noise and the movement. There are no exceptions. But today especially, take a sigh of relief, breathe a sigh of relief. They're not a distraction or a disruption. And they remind us of the life that God has given to the church. And so for them, we give thanks. And with that, I'd like to invite the McKinnon family up to lead us in our call to worship.
All right, good morning, everybody. If you don't know me, I'm Eric McKinnon. This is my wife, Tiffany, and my son, Titus. We also have a daughter in the nursery named Verity. So today we've been asked to lead in the call of worship, call to worship. So we are going to have a prayer, and we are going to ask y'all to participate with some pieces that come up in color on the screens.
And Titus intends to help with that.
Yes. So, he'll help out to cue you in on that. So here we go. Oh God, as we worship together as a family of faith today, we pray that we would be a reflection of your Son, who when asked who his family was, looked to those who sat around him. We pray that each of us would be formed by one another For the children, may we be drawn to the reverence, gratitude, and wisdom in the adults and students.
Hear our prayer!
For the adults and students, may we be drawn to the awe and wonder in the hearts of children, the acceptance, optimism, and honesty that they share.
Lord, hear our prayer!
All right, bud. That the extra noise and loud whispers, cries, and sounds of crayons to paper would be as pleasing to our ears as they are to yours, and that our time today would serve as a reminder of the life that you have created and filled our church with.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May we respond to your call to tell of your love for generations to come, to welcome the children, and to become like them. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy
And now we'll light the candle of hope.
All right, Kate.
Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down. The mountains would tremble before you, as when the fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil. come down to make your name known to your enemies and causes the nations to quake before you.
For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who act on behalf of those who wait for you, for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continue to sin against them, you were angry. How then can we be saved?
All of us have become like the one who is unclean, and our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We shriveled up like a leaf. And like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us and have given us over to our sins.
Yet you, Lord, are our Father. We are the clay and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. Oh, look on us, we pray, for we are all your people.
So the season of Advent is about waiting, anticipating, and preparing. In Isaiah 63, the prophet is speaking to God, and he said, God, just look down. Look down and see us. In 64, we just read where Isaiah asked him to come down. Not just come down. He said, rend the heavens. Now, what that means is to rip them apart and come down and be right where he is. In the rest of the passage, we read about how things have kind of become a little confusing and tough and challenging for the people. But that first verse is the key. Isaiah went from asking God to look down, and he shifts and says, God, I want you to rip the heavens apart on your way down to be here with us. Therein lies our deepest hope. Our deepest hope is to have that fullness, that closeness, that presence with God. As we share in the body and the blood, we have an opportunity to experience part of that presence. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the hope that you give us through your Son, for the opportunity that we have to remember the sacrifice that he gave us. God, thank you for being faithful to your people. Thank you for loving us. We pray that you will continue to watch after us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head. Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the head. Thou.
At this time, we are going to have a story just for the children. And Miss Angela, I'm going to go ahead and invite her up to take her spot. And I'm also going to invite any children that would like to come up and hear the story to head on up towards the stage. We're going to sing a song for you to come up. But the one thing that I would like for you to know is, and parents, you may need to help with this a little bit because I don't think children are super awesome at socially distancing. But if you could, if you're comfortable with your children coming up, you might want to come up here and help them to spread out just a little bit to keep a little bit of distance between them. While they're coming up, let's sing another song about hope.
Jesus, hope of the nations. Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history you lived and died. You broke the chains, you rose to You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we
this morning. I'm so glad you're up here. We have a special story today about a special baby. Let me ask you a question. When you hear someone say that someone is going to have a baby, what do you do with your face? How does your face look when you hear the news? There's going to be a baby. How does it look, Caroline? Does it look like this? Yes, we get so excited. But you know, in our story today, the baby was coming to a very old couple. I don't mean to be unkind. Do you know Mr. Bill and Miss Margaret Pogue? Mr. Bill and Miss Margaret, will you stand up for just a minute? They probably can't hear. They're very old. Well, everybody, y'all stand up. Y'all look back there at that couple. Look at them. Okay? Yeah? What if I were to say Mrs. Margaret is gonna have a baby? What would your face look like? Would it look like this? Yes. Well, in our story today, the man's name was Zechariah, and the woman who was gonna have the baby's name was Elizabeth. But when the angel told Zechariah that he was going to become a father, that his wife was going to have a baby, he went and he didn't believe. And when he didn't believe, this is what happened. Can you do this? Well, y'all keep doing that. He couldn't talk. He was not able to talk. And then the baby was born. Sorry. And he still couldn't talk. But our story says this. When their baby was just 8 days old, Elizabeth and her husband Zechariah took the baby to the temple. It was time to give the baby a name. He must be called Zechariah after his father, said the relatives. No, said Elizabeth. His name is John. That's what the angel told them to name the baby. But no one in your family is called John, they said. And they turned to Zechariah. He wrote these words. His name is John. And at that moment, his mouth was not closed anymore. Oh, he was happy. And his mouth opened and he began to praise God. He was filled with the Holy Spirit and he told a message from God. Some people call this message a song. Some people say that he actually sang this message. But girls and boys, this message that Zechariah said came from God. So it has two parts. Listen to the first part. I want you to really put on your listening ears. I want you to listen because I want you to tell me who is this message about. So listen. Praise to the Lord God of Israel. He has come to help his people and has given them freedom. He has given us a powerful Savior from the family of his servant David. This is what God promised long ago. We will be saved from our enemies and from all those who hate us. We will be given courage to do good things. Okay, that was message number one. Who do you think that message was about? Does anybody know?
No.
Oh. Well, let's think about it then, Titus. Oh, Aiden thinks he knows. Whoa, Jesus. Let's see. He has given us a powerful Savior. Who is our Savior? Jesus, yes. And this is what God promised long ago. So the first message that came out of Zechariah's mouth was a message about God saving his people. Let's see what the second message was, y'all. This one was so special because it was a message he sang to his son, his baby. He said, "Now you, little boy, will be a special friend of the Lord. You will help people get ready for him. You will share the news far and wide that Jesus will come to help us and care for us. It will be just like the sunrise for us." And so the baby, John, grew up. He became strong by God's Spirit. Yes, he became strong in his spirit. Now, wasn't that a sweet message that Zechariah said over his son, John? That's right, like babies. And when we think of babies, sometimes we think of singing songs to babies. Do you ever think of singing a song to a baby? Maybe you sing, "Hush, little baby, don't say a word." Have you ever heard that song? "Mama's gonna buy you a mockingbird." I always get confused on that one of who's what's going to come next. But maybe, do you think when you were a baby, some special songs were sang like this one? And you can help me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Now that song has a really special message, doesn't it? Do you think that when Zechariah's mouth was opened, it was closed. Do you think when Zechariah's mouth was opened and he used his mouth to praise God and tell wonderful messages from God, do you think that was the best way to use his mouth? Do you think that's the best way to use our mouths? Yes. 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 Oh, yes. So, we thank God for his messages. We read them in the Bible. God speaks to our heart and we pray to him. And we thank him so much for that. So, let's say a prayer right now. And then Mr. Carl's going to come teach us some more, okay? Oh, Holy Father. We thank you and we praise you for our Savior Jesus and for the baby John who grew up to be a man that prepared the way for Jesus. And Lord, we thank you that our mouths can be used to praise you and to tell your great messages, your great news about our Savior Jesus. Thank you for these children and for their families. In the holy name of Jesus, amen. Thank you for coming this morning. You can go back to your parents now.
How do you beat that? I don't know. I'm just not sure where to go from there. Great job, Miss Angela. Thank you. As we think about hope, we hope for a lot of things in life. And sometimes those hopes really happen, and sometimes they don't. We hope that we find that right person to grow old with. We hope that we get that dream job. We hope that the diagnosis from the doctor is good. We hope that our loved ones are safe in the path of the storm. We hope that trophy buck walks out in front of us and stands broadside for us to take the shot. We hope our favorite football team wins. We hope that we don't get that teacher that hands out homework like we don't have a social life. And we hope that our son doesn't stop by our house and eat all of our peanut butter cups while we're at work. Some things we hope for and they come true, and sometimes those things we hope for, they don't come true. But in our lesson of hope today, I heard a story about a school system in a large city, and in this school system they had so many students, and as the students were out sick or even if they were in the hospital, there was a program where they would send a tutor to tutor that child so they wouldn't fall too far behind in their classwork. And so a certain program teacher got a call one day, and the regular teacher said, I have a student, and he's in the hospital right now. This is his room number. And right now we're going over nouns and verbs. And so I'd like for you to tutor him in that. And so the program teacher showed up at the hospital the next day, walked into the room, and she wasn't prepared for what she saw. She saw a young boy laying there, and he had some really bad burns on his body. And so she tried to stay focused, and she continued with the lesson and taught him the nouns and the verbs. She left, and she didn't feel very good about the way things went. So when she came back the next day, the nurse stopped her and said, "What did you say to this boy yesterday?" And the teacher thought she did something wrong, and before she could say anything, the nurse said, "He is a totally different child. We were so afraid for him because he had lost hope, and he wasn't trying, but today he's a fighter. He's responding to treatments. He's doing really well. It's like things changed overnight." And so a few weeks later, the boy was asked about that time, and he said, "Yes, I did give up hope. Yes, I didn't want to fight anymore. But then that teacher came into my room and started tutoring me, and I thought, why would they send a teacher to teach me about nouns and verbs if I was going to die?" See, hope is what keeps us going. But see, the thing that maybe we get confused about in hope is, what is our hope in? Because if our hope's in anything of this world, it's a lost hope. It could go either way. With some things in this world, we hope, and some people even cross their fingers, "Oh, I really hope this, I really hope that." That's not the hope that we're talking about. That's not the hope that Zechariah and Elizabeth had. That's not the hope that Zechariah talked about in his song of praise. See, the hope that we have as believers in Jesus Christ is that we have an eternal home in heaven that's waiting for us at the end of this journey. That we have help, that God walks alongside of us, that His Holy Spirit is right here inside of us, and that we don't have to be afraid of anything. But as we look at the beginning, as we're introduced to Zechariah the priest, he's in Luke chapter 1, starting around verse 13, we see where this angel, Zechariah is burning incense in the temple. The people are praying outside, and as he's in there, he's surprised. And he's surprised by this angel, and the angel said in verse 13, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth." Verse 16, "Many of the people of Israel will be brought back to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." What awesome news this is that Zechariah gets. They're not only going to have a baby in their advanced years, they thought they would never have one, but he's going to do some great and awesome things. He is actually going to prepare the way for the Messiah. And if we try to put ourselves in Zechariah's place, I'm not sure how we would respond. This is a word coming from God himself. He's seeing the angel Gabriel right there. In verse 18, Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." And just as a side note, men, I can't think of a single time or circumstance where the words that come out of our mouth are, "My wife is well along in years." I can't think of it. So Zechariah was bold enough to say it. Elizabeth wasn't around, so maybe he could, but he can't imagine this happening after years and years and years. And I can't help but think that somewhere along the line that he lost hope. That he kind of threw in the towel. And I have to admit, I'm a little confused about how the angel talked to Zechariah and said, "Your prayer has been heard," because I'm not sure exactly what prayer that is. How could Zechariah be continuing to pray, "God, allow us to have a baby," and then all of a sudden he says, "Well, how can that happen?" It almost makes me lean toward the thought that maybe he was praying for the Messiah to come. And he knew that as that Messiah would come, that someone in the spirit of Elijah would come along before him and pave the way. And so his prayer has been answered really in two different ways. Yes, the Messiah is coming, and guess what? You and Elizabeth are going to have a baby, and he's going to pave the way. And he's going to restore hope for the people. But because of his doubt, Gabriel in verse 19, Gabriel said, I am Gabriel, I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. Have you ever had anyone talk to you and you think the conversation is going one way and you're like, oh yeah, it's great, and all of a sudden, boom, it takes a turn. And I can't help but think about Gabriel kind of doing that here because he says, hey, this is great news. But verse 20, he says, and now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at the proper time. Zechariah lost hope. And even though he got a word from an angel, he got a word directly from God, he still struggled with the hopelessness of years and years and years of not having baby, the years and years of waiting on the Messiah to come. And so God knows he needs time to think about this. He needs time to pray about this, and these hopeless words can't be coming out of his mouth anymore. So you know what, Zechariah, it's time for you to wait to take a couple months not to say anything and to reflect and to think. It's even believed that there was a possibility that Zechariah, he couldn't just not talk, but maybe he couldn't hear either. Because when the baby John came in verse 62, it talks about the people. Elizabeth wanted to name him John, and the people said, well, there's nobody in your family named John. Hey, name him Junior. Zechariah Junior, that's a good name. And so they looked at Zechariah and said, what do you think? But it says that they made signs to his father. So maybe he couldn't hear. Maybe they thought just because he couldn't speak, they needed to make out signs. I don't know. But he had months and months to think about those hopeless words, those faithless words that he said. And so he follows the instruction of God and the angel of God, Gabriel, and he writes down on that sign, his name is John. And you know, immediately after that happened, verse 64 says, immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue was loosed. Immediately after he knew that this hope had come true, immediately after, as he saw this baby being born, and now he's named John, hey, the prophecy is going to continue. His son is going to pave the way for the Messiah. Immediately he's able to speak. And so the last words he spoke before this were faithless words, were words that didn't have any hope. But then his mouth is opened and his tongue is loosed, and he began to speak, praising God. The neighbors were all filled with awe, and throughout the whole hill country of Judea, people were talking about all these things. Verse 66, everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, what then is this child going to be? For the Lord's hand was with him. You see, as soon as Zechariah was able to speak, words of praise started coming out of his mouth. Words of hope, words of faith started coming out of his mouth so loudly the people outside the temple heard it, the people outside the city heard it, and the whole hill country of Judea. And I can't help but think that it's greater than, I don't want to say just having a baby, because having a... I want to put this carefully. Some of the best days of my lives were when my children were born. So it's a great time. It's an awesome time. But is it this awesome to be screaming and praising and then to sing this song? I believe it was a greater joy. It was an eternal joy. Yes, he was ecstatic over having a son. And the angel even said, he's going to be a blessing to you and Elizabeth. I'm sure that it was just awesome having that child grow up before he and Elizabeth's eyes. And yet I think it goes a lot deeper than that. Because his hope just wasn't in having a baby, but it was in spiritual things, in the Messiah, in eternal things. And so that's when he wrote this song, or he sang this song in verse 67. It starts about Zechariah being filled with the Holy Spirit. He prophesied. And as Miss Angela so boldly pointed out, the first part of this song is about Jesus, is about the Messiah, and then he turns to his son, and he prophesies over his son. But as he talks about the Messiah, he mentions him as the Redeemer. He says, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people. He has saved his people. He not only he's going to free them, but he redeemed them." Part of redemption, or a definition of being redeemed, is someone that's in prison. They're in a jail. And that door opens up of the jail, and someone paid the price for their bail or for their freedom, and they're able to walk out that door. And that's part of what Jesus will do here and what he has done. But it's not just redeeming his people, but in verse 69 it says, "He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David." This horn of salvation is a symbol of power and a symbol of strength. It's a symbol of totally overcoming the enemy. The horn of salvation can be used in a military term, where an army is in battle and the enemy is just about to take that army captive. The enemy is just about to take that army and either make them slaves or annihilate them. But then at the last minute, the reinforcements come in. And as the reinforcements come in, they just totally annihilate the enemy and there's nothing left. The hope that we have is that Jesus Christ came and he annihilated the enemy. He annihilated the evil one. And we don't have to be afraid. He goes on to say in verse 74 that he came to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear. In verse 76, Zechariah goes on and says, "And you, my child..." I can just imagine him, you know, maybe he was speaking over him, but I just imagine him holding him in his hands and said, "And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High. For you will go before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide their feet into the path of peace." Verse 80, "And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly in Israel." See, this young baby John is going to grow up in the spirit of Elijah, and he's going to be this voice to the people. He's going to be this voice of repentance. He's going to be the one that paves the way and says, you know, someone is going to come along behind me that's even greater than me. And he has to become more, and then I have to become less. But until that time, John spoke of redemption. He spoke of, when we look at that, at the text there in verse 77, he talked about the forgiveness of sin, this assurance. See, we can be sure. Our hope is in sure things. We don't hope, "Oh, I hope I go to heaven one day." Those of us who are believers in Christ Jesus are going to heaven. And God wants us to be sure of that and sure of that hope. It's not a hope, "I hope that happens." It's a hope, "Yes, it will happen," because God keeps his promises. God is predictable in that way. Man is very unpredictable. This world is very unpredictable when we put our hope in things of this world. But when we put our hope in God, we will never, ever be disappointed. When we put our hope in God, he's going to shine that light on our darkness. Even in the shadow of death, God's light is going to shine on those who hope in him. This is awesome, wonderful news. And we're never going to be disappointed. If we go ahead to Romans chapter 5, in closing, Romans chapter 5, starting about the middle of verse 2. Romans chapter 5 says, "And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom He has given us." This hope that we read about here in Romans is a hope that's not going to disappoint. Is a hope that in God's promises and in God's love, Zechariah talks about the tender, loving mercy of God. We read here about the true love of God, and our hope is based on that love, and that love is unfailing. And we're never going to be disappointed. I teach a class at the prison that I go to, and it's called a fatherhood class. And in one of our sections, I ask the men the question, if your 10-year-old self was standing right here in front of you, what would you tell them? If your 10-year-old self was standing right here in front of you, what would you tell them? And we get the comments of, well, I tell my 10-year-old self, listen to your mother. I would tell my 10-year-old self, get better friends. I would tell my 10-year-old self, do better in school. A few weeks ago, I had a new one. One of the men said, I would tell my 10-year-old self, when you're 22 years old, don't walk into that bank and try to rob it. And then it's my turn. If my 10-year-old self were standing right here, what would I tell him? I would tell little 10-year-old Carl, it's going to be okay. I'd tell 10-year-old Carl, it's going to get better. Just persevere. And then I hear my 10-year-old sarcastic self looking at me and saying, I can't believe I'm bald. And then I can hear him say, what does persevere mean? And I tell him to keep on going. When you're knocked down, get up and keep on moving forward. And I believe that's what God is telling each and every one of us today, because there's hope in the future. We may feel like we're in hopeless situations now, but we have an eternal hope that nobody can take away, that's based on God's promises, and we can bank on that. So if God were here speaking to us today, I believe that He would be saying, keep pressing on, persevere. Don't give up, and you'll never be disappointed. Let's pray. Father in heaven, God, we are so grateful to you, Father, for John, who paved the way for the Messiah, for your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. God, we are grateful to you for the hope that we have in your Son. We are thankful to you, God, for the way that you love us. God, for your tender mercy. We thank you, God, for your unfailing love. We're thankful to you, Father, that you shine your light on our lives when we feel like we're in darkness, even when we feel like we are in the shadow of death. God, you are here with us, and you give us hope. Father, help us to persevere. Help each of us, God, to keep on going and to continue to have that hope in you. And God, that hope will shine in our lives, not even necessarily by the words that we say, but by our actions. And that hope will inspire others. God, thank you that when we put our hope in you, that we will never be disappointed. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Stand with us
and sing. There is an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music.
amazing is your love. How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart want to sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me through, and sing the songs you from singing your praise. How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wants to sing.
As we learn and practice the value of hope this week, in this Advent season, you are sent not to keep it to yourself.
Rather to share hope with your friends and neighbors that our world might become more hopeful.
You are sent into the world to be the people of hope, to create a more hopeful world today and every day.
Have a great week. You are sent.